Yes, I think it's. Yes, we received your video. Please, you can start. Yes, please.
Okay, the audio was already recorded. Anyway, so this is a presentation. This presentation is concerned the optimization of the urban traffic through techniques that are related to the computational intelligence. The aims of the optimization of traffics are to reduce fuel consumption, air pollution, and reduce the stress and diseases related to pollution of people. Can you go ahead? No? A key element of the of an intelligent traffic management system is the cap is capability to forecasting short-term forecasting of the urban traffic. While in freeway traffic forecasting, the state of the road is almost stable. In case of in case of the forecasting urban and urban traffic, we see a rapid change of the traffic re behavior, and so and moreover the sensor available sensor are limited. So there are many approaches to traffic forecasting in urban scale concerning techniques using parametric models, machine learning, and hybrid approaches that combine both techniques. Okay, concerning the approach with the non-parametric models, we have learning machines like multi-layer perceptron, fuzzy neural models, multitask neural network, and many other techniques. Okay, what we want to do in our approach is to model through a dynamic clustering technique, the non-stationary data streams coming from the traffic in order to have a dynamic model. So the clustering process will adapt to streaming data. And so we implement a continuous learning that exploits the input patterns as they arrive to the machine. We will construct an ensemble of forecasters or predictors, each one acting on a single cluster of data. Okay, the data streams are a very important paradigm in the data science today. The data streams arise from many sources, so they are connected to the Internet of Things. So we have sources from wearable sensors, the web, smart home and cities, etc. Moreover, when we analyze big data, sometimes we need to obtain a model online during the observation of those data, because in a single pass, because we cannot read again the data. In our approach, we distinguish two cases, the constant drift and the constant shift. The constant drift is related to data that changes slowly with respect to the sampling rate of our system. So they are quasi stationary phenomena, while constant shift is related to cases where the change of the data distribution is very fast, is faster than the sampling rate. The model will be valid for a limited time for in constant shift, while it will be stable, the validity is stable for more time constant drift. Go ahead, please. Okay, now we have some mathematics. So we consider the set of, we consider data modeled by a set of C clusters yj, and each cluster is associated indicator function that is called fuzzy membership. So XL to J is the membership of data XL to the cluster J. Is a number between 0 and 1 in the closing interval 0, 1. So usually the membership depends on the distance of the centroids, and many clustering algorithms, fuzzy clustering algorithms have a cost function related to the expectation of the distortion. The distortion is the distance, the discrepancies between the data and the centroids. Moreover, there is usually people set a constraints called probabilistic constraints that say that the sum of membership of data element to all cluster is 1. But this value that is in this slide is a sigma. Is key equation 4 is called the total mass.
Professor Masuli?
Yeah?
I'm sorry to interrupt you, but can we share the video?
Yeah, sure, this is better.
Okay, it's, to continue the project. Ah, nice, very nice. I think it's more easy. Okay.
It's easier.
Yes, it's more easy. Thank you very much. Go ahead, please.
I share. Okay, I share. Okay. So okay. Uh, D is the cost function of clustering, fuzzy clustering techniques, probabilistic models of clusters. Yes, a moment. Okay. Now, the maximum entropy. Proposed Arose and others in the 90s is based on the Lagrangian, the minimization of the Lagrangian, where D is the cost function of that we already seen, plus the entropy of clusters, plus the a term U that is the probabilistic constraint. Okay, the solutions is of this the minimization are given the, by the gradient of the Lagrangian set to zero that yields for the minimum condition the same equation for the centroids yj and this equation for the memberships of the membership of a data point to a cluster. The term V and J is the so-called membership that is a Gibbs function, not a normalized Gibbs function. Z in for U L and J is the normalization factor called partition function. Beta in the solution is the spread of the cluster that in physics corresponds to temperature. So the deterministic annealing is a procedure where we anneal the temperature beta. We have an annealing schedule on temperature beta. So we start with a very high temperature where all cluster collapse in the in a unique cluster with the barycenter in the with the center that is a barycenter of the data set, and then we reduce the temperature and in many steps, so a schedule of temperature. And at each level of temperature, we minimize the cost function until we arrive to beta equal zero. That is the solution. The solution for corresponding to the R clustering, the Kimmings algorithm. In the possibilistic clustering algorithm, we relax the constraint on the mass of membership key L. So the membership are not equivalent to probabilities, but represents degrees of typicality to clusters. So we change the objective function. So we add a term to the cost function of the original cost function, we add a term W that is an entropic terms that in this way the necessary condition for the minimum of the cost the objective function becomes U Lj equal to the free energy. So we have the Gibbs function, not normalized. The graduate possibilistic means proposed by our group is a way to generalize the membership function. So we still have Z, this term that is the normalized factor ZL, but ZL is power alpha, where alpha is a value between 0 and 1. So when alpha is equal to 0, this term becomes 1. So U al J is the same value, is the same definition of free energy than the membership of the possibilistic simin. Why? If alpha is equal 1, we have the deterministic annealing membership. I recall that the cost function, the evaluation of centroids remains the same than that I presented before here, this one. Okay, I go ahead. Okay, we are here. So consider also intermediate cases where we have alpha in between 0 and 1. So we have the possibility to change the role of the normalization function. So it could be very strong or null or 1. In this way, we could have a stronger rejection to outliers. I should better. So consider alpha equal 1. So we have the deterministic annealing clustering. So deterministic annealing is probabilistic. So consider the distribution of points. They are generated on this line, so we have as a unidimensional with the two Gaussians. They are they have a body center in minus dot five and dot five. So they are this way. The membership function obtained by a probabilistic clustering model gives low membership to one cluster when we are inside the other cluster, while the membership to an assigned cluster is larger and continue to be larger at the plus minus infinity for the cluster blue and to plus infinity for cluster red. When we are in the middle of the two distribution of data, the membership are 0.5. If we use alpha equal 0, we have the possibilistic version of the algorithm. So in this way we are able to model very precisely the two Gaussian distributions, but and also we notice that at infinity plus infinity minus infinity, both of them are 0, and in between the two masses of points the membership are low. So this allows us to cancel outliers when they are far from the two distributions and inside them, in between them. We notice that with the possibilistic approach, we have a problem of convergence because we don't have a competitive evaluation membership among the cluster. I want to show better going back. Okay, for example, I would prefer to see this. Okay, here we see that this term contains the membership to the other clusters. So the evaluation of membership is competitive. Instead, for this evaluation, that is the one of possibilistic clustering, there is not competition. We could perform clustering, applying the iteration of the membership and of the centroids in cluster by cluster. Okay. With a graded value, for example, alpha equal 0.8, we have a good modeling of the two distributions, so high rejection to cluster, to outliers, and also we have a model that is quite competitive, so we can find convergence of the iteration process. In order to model data streams, we implement a continuous learning from the input data as they arrive. We define a sliding windows W that is update every S observation, deleting the S oldest ones. The size of W remains constant. Before incorporating the new S observation in the window, we collect them in a so-called prop set that we will use for outlier analysis. We consider two cases, batch learning, where S and W are larger than one, that are adequate for concept drift, and a case of online learning where W contains only one pattern, only one observation that will be useful for concept shift. If the total mass membership key L defined as the sum of membership of the data point R to all clusters is about one, the observation XL belongs to the two region well covered by centroids. If key R will be larger, very large than one, XL belongs to region with many overlapping clusters. If the total mass of membership XL is less than one, XL belongs to regions not covered by centroid, so it's an outlier. We define the outlierness index omega of XL as the membership of XL to the fuzzy set of outliers. We can define the index omega of XL as the maximum between 0 and 1 or minus the total membership mass of Excel. Given omega of Excel, we can define the outlierness density, rho of a probe set S in this way, as the degree, the anomaly of outliers that accounts for the frequency intensity at which outliers occur. And also we can define M as the maximum outlierness of the set S. So we can introduce a function theta that depends on rho and M to control the learning regimes. If M is high and rho is low, then theta is zero. This is a fuzzy rule of Sugeno's type. So if theta is zero, it means we have outliers. So we don't learn, we don't apply any learning rule. No learning. If theta is about zero, that happens when M is low and rho is low, with another fuzzy rule of Sugeno types, we are in stability. So the model remains the same. So we have a concept shift and we perform incremental learning. If M is high and rho is high, then theta is one. So when we have theta order of one, we have a plasticity. That means the model changes completely. And we are in the case of the concept drift, and we have to perform relearning. Batch learning, as we already stated, is adequate for concept drift. That means that generation rate is high, is much higher than the rate of change. And update of the model are made every S observations. So to this aim, we implement a deterministic annealing optimization with annealing schedule controlled by theta. The updated rules for the centroids and the membership are given by those two equations. So you see that the centroids moves changes with a factor that is related to position of the new data in the window W. And this change is controlled by eta, that is a learning rate. Concerning the membership, we have the membership of the graded possibilistic C-means algorithm, controlled by alpha. We apply online learning when we have a concept shift, that means the data generation learn rate of the source is much higher than its rate of change. So in this case, we have a window large one data from development of the Citroën J towards the new data sample Excel averaged by the membership of Excel to YJ and using a learning rate that multiplied this quantity, the product, and eta is a, could be also function the time. Concerning the memberships, we maintain the definition of membership given by the graduate possibilistic SIMIN. On those basis, we implemented a short-term urban traffic flow forecasting. So there are two issues affecting the performance of this kind of forecast. The dimension of the training sites, that is the number of observation patterns used to train the forecaster, and the and handling of outliers. So we should filter outliers in order to because they reduce the model performance. Another issue affecting the performance of the forecaster is the selection of the optimal lag period tau. We represent a pattern in our model as time lag vectors. So we need to select the optimal lag period. If it's too small, we will be not able to distinguish between the vectors in the and if it is too large, the vector will be uncorrelated. So tau will be selected as the minimum of the delay of the time delayed mutual information following the techniques proposed by Fraser and others in the context of dynamical system theory. The model we propose is called a layered ensemble model. And in the learning stage, we perform clustering using the graded possibilistic SIMIN, obtaining key groups of patterns, where patterns are time lag vectors from the time series. For each pattern, we measure the outlierness degree, but in this case, instead to use omega, we use the minimum, the using the total mass of membership, and then we take in account the minimum of this value on all the data set. In the second layer of the of our model, we train key forecaster based on multi-layer perceptrons using for each of them using the data belonging to one cluster. So, the schematic of our model, we have the training patterns. We normalize them and construct the time lag vectors, we cluster them in key different clusters using the graded possibilistic clustering algorithm. We take an account on the minimum of the mass of membership among all patterns, and then we have the clusters, and we construct a forecaster using the data belonging to the relate cluster. Okay, when we have completed the training stage, we can forecast new patterns. For each upcoming pattern, we check the mass of memberships, and in case that this value is under the threshold T we have set during learning, we reject them because we consider it as an outlier. For patterns that are accepted by the model, we perform a number of predictions, one for each forecaster we have already trained, and then we perform a mixture of experts by obtaining the file flow forecasting through the weighted sum of the output of all forecasters, multiplied the membership of the patterns, the new pattern to the related cluster, and dividing by the mass of membership. So we have the new pattern. We measure the membership of it to all the different clusters through the application of the graded possibilistic SIMINS. We check its membership mass, its mass of memberships, and if it is under the threshold, we reject the prediction. Otherwise, we take the output of the different forecasters related to the clusters, and then we average them by multiply with the membership to the associate clusters and dividing by the mass of membership. We have tested our model on the UK agency network journey time and traffic flow data. That is a data series providing traffic flow information from different loop sensors for 15 minutes from 2009 till now on most of the road links in UK. So we are concentrated on a particular loop sensor, and we have trained our model with five different clusters. And here we see the first five traffic flow patterns in cluster one. You see the good overlapping of them. So you see the size of this with the window, temporal window, and the on the x-axis, while on the vertical axis we have the flow. This is the graph for the second cluster, for the third cluster. Okay. Concerning experimentation, we have used another data set that was a simulated data set of the urban roads of Genova. And in particular, we modeled the this part of the road network from the hills till the sea. In here there is a stadium. Okay, from the photograph we can extract, we were able to extract the model, and using this model, this graph, we perform the simulations. In this table, we see the characteristic of the two simulations. For UK data set, we consider a lag period of one day, that means 96 observation. The observation period is 15 minutes, and we trained the system for a period of 9 months, and we tested it on a period of 3 months. The networks were trained by 10 fold cross validations. The network were neural networks. We use three networks with three layers, shallow networks, and we use 5 clusters, so we had an ensemble of 5 neural networks. Alpha was a value between 0 and 1, close to 1, with a beta of 0.1 for the scheduling, for the annealing. For the general data set, we consider a lag period of 15 minutes, and considering the observation from coming from three road links, the observation period is 5 minutes, the historical training time was 6 hours, and the test period was 3 hours. For the rest, we have similar details. Okay, those are the scatter plots between the target and the output. So what we add to obtain as a forecasting, so they are the real data, and on the vertical there are the output of our network. You see that the correlation is strong between the two lines, is strong. The same happens with the Genova dataset. This line that is related to the dataset UK, we see that if alpha is too high, we have a large mean square error and small rejection of outliers. Instead, if alpha is smaller, we have a quantity of rejection to outlier, 0.06%, while we have an improvement on the mean square error. Okay. So, LEM, LEIM, our model, is a good candidate for being included in a traffic management system. And in this way, the local administration could decongest the traffic and reduce the time of journeys. So we optimize the energy saving, the pollution reduction, and the quality of life related both to health and stress. Okay, the last slide is a very quick presentation of our research group. We are located in the University of Genova in Italy. We develop a theory of a neural network, fuzzy logic, and evolutionary algorithms, and we perform the application to industry, smart communities, and health. We are 2 permanent staffs and 6 students and postdocs. We have also a spin-off company called Vega Research Laboratories. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Masciulli. Thank you also once again for your participation. I would like to mention for the audience, if you have any question, please send it by email to can Professor Masciulli answers you after. And now, please all, I welcome all participants to join their sessions. Please go to your session. We're gonna start now. Thank you very much. Thank you, Professor Masciulli. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Goodbye.
Goodbye. Thank you very much.